welcome. Special day today, big treat, because Jody's out of town. So I know you're going to enjoy this morning. Actually, we're very blessed to have a preacher who wants to be at his home church. And so you probably realize by now he almost always is, but he is on much deserved vacation this week, and he'll be back in the office tomorrow. We're glad that you're here. Do have a special friend from the past. Chris Harrell is here. Chris was a youth minister here for several years, 14 years ago. Is that right? Something like that? Just go with it. Just nod. Okay, thank you. Chris and his lovely wife, Polly, and their two sons live in Jonesboro, Arkansas. Chris is the associate minister, now preaching 50% of the time at the Southwest Church in Jonesboro. And their oldest, Jake, where did Jake go? Jake's right here. See, Jake was born here, and so he feels like you're his people. He is a big Alabama fan, even though he's always lived in Arkansas for the majority of his life. And so he says that's a really tough cross to bear over there. So Jake has just been happy to be back in his hometown, even though it was only a couple of months. Chris has been a great friend. We've been close for many, many years, even after his leaving here. And I got to be honest, Chris, he loves the Lord. He loves to preach. He loves to work with people. And Chris is the only person that I've ever worked with who actually cursed in an elders meeting. And boy, did he have everybody's attention. So make sure that you stay with him this morning so he doesn't have to do that here in front of all of you as well. Hey, let's stand and say hi to someone around us, and we'll continue our worship in just a minute.
As we wait upon the Lord, wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord, wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the rose on high, who died eternal life to bring, and lives that death may die. Majesty, Lord of all, let every throne before him fall, the King of kings, O come.
Made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone, and the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them,
"Take courage. It is I. Don't be afraid."
"Lord, if it is you, tell me to come out to you on the water."
"Come."
Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, cried out,
"Lord, save me."
Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him.
"You of little faith, why did you doubt?"
And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly you are the Son of God."
Let's take our offering.
Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all above all. above all peace, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man. You were here before the world began, above all kingdoms, above all.
Question. What is your favorite song? And this is a rhetorical question. I don't expect you to shout it out. But do you have one? And I don't mean just a favorite song that's for today or this week or even this month. I mean a favorite song that you've had year in, year out. It's been a favorite song. I want you, if you've got one, just think about that song. Why is it special to you? Is it because of the tune? Is it because of the music? Or is it because of the words? Is it because of the message? Or is it a combination? I think of Marna's dad, my wife's dad. I know he had a couple of songs that he was fond of, I think mainly because they spoke of home. And they spoke of the state of Kentucky. But I know he had one song in particular that I would say was his favorite. And the reason I say that is because it wasn't uncommon for him to just randomly or just on the spur of the moment just repeat the first line of that song. And whether he said or he spoke the rest of that song, the rest of the message of that song came to mind. It's because the first line itself was enough to suggest what the rest of that song was about. This is an old song, "O Lord My God." I can see him saying that or singing it. And he would sing it or say it just as an exclamation, really, of joy or of thanksgiving, or maybe even a somber reflection, just depending on what was going on at the moment. "O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed." It's the song, "How Great Thou Art." I've got another question for you. What was Jesus' favorite song? Did he have one? Nobody knows. I certainly can't say. But I firmly believe that Psalm 22 was a very important song to him. Was it because of the tune? You know, in all the modern translations, there are instructions in the introduction to Psalm 22 that talk to the praise leader, calls out the tune by name. Or was it because of the message of that song? I think you could build a case for it being one of his favorite songs. In fact, I think one piece of strong evidence is the fact that that psalm, Psalm 22, verse 1, starts out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Now, if you're familiar at all, people who are at all familiar with the Gospels, of course, recognize that immediately as one of the last things that Jesus said from the cross. It's also one of the most bewildering things that he said from the cross, because it is so contrary to the whole resolve that he demonstrated, to all the teaching that he told his apostles, his disciples, his followers, especially that last week when he said, I'm going to be killed. In fact, that statement is contrary to not only everything else that he said on the cross, it's contrary to the rest of the life that he lived, the purpose, his single purpose in coming to earth. So what is that psalm about? Well, the first 20 verses or so of that psalm describe great suffering, but they also describe in tremendous accuracy and detail the crucifixion of Jesus. It talks about the fact that he was mocked. It talks about the fact that his hands and his feet were pierced. It talks about the fact that people gambled. They cast lots for his clothes. But what does the rest of that psalm say? The last 10 verses they are a praise to God who knew from the very beginning that he was going to redeem us through the life of Jesus Christ. In fact, the very last verse of Psalm 22 is really the crescendo. It says, for they shall praise his righteousness. They shall declare to peoples, to generations yet unborn, he has done it. What was Jesus' favorite song? I don't know. But I think this is an important song to him. I think because he shouted the first verse from the cross. I think because it talks of his suffering in great detail, in great prophetic specificity. I think because it praises God for the plan of salvation through Jesus from the beginning of time. And I think because this song was even old when Jesus was familiar with it. It was literally 1,000 years old when Jesus was born. Let's pray. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name. We praise thee for loving us. We praise you for the plan that you have had for us since the beginning of time, that washes away all of our sins, that reconciles us to you, that makes us perfect in spite of all our imperfections, that makes us reconciled to you for all of eternity. We're thankful for your Son. We're thankful that he is the bread of life. Thankful that he instituted this meal. And as we reflect on that bread that he broke, representative of his body, the bread of life. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide. Where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender. I'm in all of you, where your love ran red and my sin washed white. I owe all to you, I owe all to you, Jesus.
What a lyric, where your blood, where your love flowed red and our sins were made white. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the blood of Christ. It does cleanse our sins. It washes away every stain. It washes away and makes us your children. And Father, we love being your adopted children. Father, thank you for the blood. Thank you for its cleansing power, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
There's a place where sin and shame are powerless, where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all the love I've ever found comes like comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you. I'm in all of you. Where My hope is found here, on holy ground. Here I bow down, here I bow down. Here, arms open wide, here you save my life. Here I bow down, here I bow. At the cross, I surrender. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. When your love ran red and my sin was white, I owe all to you, 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 Jesus.
Let's stand.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil what we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. We are your church. Power in us. We seek your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst. Refuse to waste our lives, for you're our joy and prize. To see the captives' hearts release, the hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. We lay down our lives for heaven's cause. And love of Christ. We are your church. We are the hope on earth. Build your kingdom here. Let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand. Heal our streets and land. Set your church on fire. Win this nation back, change the atmosphere, build your kingdom here, build your kingdom here, let the darkness fear, show your mighty hand, heal our streets and land, set your church on fire, win this nation back, change the
Good morning, church. Oh, I want to thank Lincoln for that wonderful introduction. I just want to be real upfront with you. I was not saved at that point, and I had a baptism of fire right after that meeting. Hey, I'm thankful for you. I'm thankful for your ministry. I am thankful that 17 years ago, you hired some wild and crazy guy from Nashville, Tennessee to come here and do youth ministry, and you loved on us, and you celebrated our wedding, and then the birth of our oldest, Jake, and you blessed us, so thank you for your role in our lives. We appreciate it very, very much. And I could try to name all the people who have profoundly impacted us during our time here, but I would surely leave someone out, so I'm not even going to try this morning. But thank you. Thank you for praying for us and for blessing us and for sending us out in ministry and allowing us to be here. We still remark that right not long after we'd been here, we got to take a group of students to Honduras. And I look back on that, and I'm like, what were they thinking to let us do that? So thank you. You're a trusting and faithful bunch. Have you ever been on a trip and everything is going just as planned, and then suddenly something happens that begins to mess things up? We were in Florida several weeks ago. We took a vacation with my wife's family, and it's the first time all of us had gone on vacation together, and we're in this little island called Cape San Blas. It's out in the middle of nowhere. Nobody goes there, so you don't go there either. I mean, it's glorious, and it's beautiful, and it is calm, and it is peaceful. And so we're in this house with all of our family, and Polly and I go to the grocery store to get a few things. And the grocery store is about 20 minutes away or so, I think 23 minutes to be exact, from where our house was. And so we drive down to the grocery store, we drive back. There's no one out on the road. It's just a two-lane road back into town and then back out on the island. And I'm just driving around. I'm having the best time. Vacation is glorious, and it is wonderful. And then I see a sheriff. And all of a sudden, his lights come on. And that fight or flight instinct sits in, and I just slam on the gas and just, whoom, just keep going. And then Polly says, you better slow down. And he pulls me over, and he walks up to the car. And in the day and age that we live in, unfortunately, he just kind of sheepishly walks up beside the car. He's looking in, and I'm thinking, don't move. He'll tase me, and that'd be a really bad way for our vacation to go. And all these things would happen. And that begins to dawn on me, like, I have no idea where the insurance card is located in our car. And so I start searching through our email, and I keep thinking it's the insurance agent's fault because he didn't send me the card, but really knowing it's my fault. You know that justification thing that you do? He says, sir, do you know how fast you were going? And I said, oh, I have no idea. I was daydreaming. And I'm thinking I'm just going 2 or 3 miles over the speed limit. I was going 13 miles over the speed limit on a two-lane road. I think I was going 58 and a 45. And I thought, I'm going to go to jail right here. This is going to be the end of me right here. And so he gets the information from me. He walks back to his car. He walks back up to me again, and he says, this car is registered in the state of Alabama, not Arkansas. And I said, listen, I've not lived in Alabama for a really long time. He goes, well, I'm going to need some more information. I thought he's going to ask for the insurance card. I'm going to go to jail, you know, all these sort of things. Anyway, by the grace of God, I get off scot-free. And Polly comments on just how righteous I must be to have not gotten a speeding ticket. No, she didn't really say that. She knows better. But you know, there are those moments when you're traveling and everything's going great and all of a sudden things fall apart. And Jesus' disciples had those same moments. In Luke's gospel in chapter 9 and verse 51, Jesus set himself resolutely towards Jerusalem. And the disciples are so excited because they know when Jesus arrives in Jerusalem, the party is on. Jesus is going to be king, and they cannot wait. They are counting down the moments until he crosses over the threshold, so they see that welcome to Jerusalem sign, and they know that finally the moment has arrived when they will be sitting in the seats of honor. And then Jesus messes things up. Because in Luke 19, there's a story told about a wee little man, a little guy we call Zacchaeus. And you know the kids' songs that go along with the story of Zacchaeus. But here's what happens in the story of Zacchaeus. Jesus is invited to a tax collector's house, and the religious people begin to mumble amongst themselves and say, see, he eats with the tax collectors and the sinners. And Jesus says, because I came to seek and save the lost. And probably at that point, the disciples are okay with what's going on. But then Jesus has just one more parable to tell before he crosses into Jerusalem. And this morning, that's the parable I want us to look at. So if you've got a Bible, I want to encourage you to turn to the Gospel of Luke. It's in the New Testament. It's a story written about Jesus from Luke's perspective. So if you've got a New Testament, if you're new to it, it's Matthew, Mark, and then Luke. And we're going to be in chapter 19. It's a parable that Jesus tells about 10 minas, M-I-N-A-S. And so the way the parable starts is Jesus talks about a man who was going to be made king. He was going to leave and go being made king, and then he was going to come back. And so Jesus tells the parable that the master there, who was going to go off and be made king and come back, that he calls 10 of his servants together and he lines them up, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And then he begins to work down the line by handing each one of them a mina, which was equivalent to 3 or 4 months' worth of salary. So he hands them each a mina, and then the master leaves and he goes and becomes king and he comes back. So you've got the servants who are there stewarding the minas that have been given to them, and then also the story tells us there in Luke chapter 19 that there are subjects who did not want this man to become king. Essentially, they hated him. So the man goes off and becomes king, and then he comes back. And when he comes back, he lines up the 10 servants, and he comes to evaluate what has happened. Now, when he tells them, when he gives them this mina and he tells them to put it to work, really a better translation of Scripture would be to make a profit with it. And so he lines them up, 1 through 10, to evaluate them because he wants to see what kind of profit they have made with what he has given them. So the first one stands before him and says, "Master, I've taken your 1 and I've turned it into 10. And so the first part of this is 1 to 10. He's given them, the master gives him 10 cities to take care of. The second servant says, "Well, I took your mina and I turned it into 5. And so the master says, "Well, you now have 5 cities to take care of." And then there's a third one. Let's pick up in the text in Luke chapter 19, starting in verse 20. "Then another servant came and said, 'Sir, here's your mina. I have kept it laid away in a piece of cloth. I was afraid of you because you are a hard man. You take out what you did not put in and reap what you did not sow.' And his master replied, 'I will judge you by your own words, you wicked servant. You knew, did you, that I am a hard man, taking out what I did not put in and reaping what I did not sow. Why then didn't you put my money on deposit so that when I came back, I could have collected it with interest?'" Interestingly enough, more space is given in this parable to the wicked servant than anyone else. See, the third servant has a completely skewed perspective of the master. And so he takes that one mina and does nothing with it, and Jesus refers to him as a wicked servant. So why did he take that one mina and not put it to use? Because in verse 21 he says, "I was afraid of you." He doubts the character of the master, and so he responds in slanderous ways. What sort of relationship would this servant have had with the master and the community that he would have responded in this way? If you go on to read verses 24 and 25, the third servant is condemned on his words. His one is taken away, and fear is what kept him from putting the mina to work. See, catch this about the third servant. He's part of the community. He's engaged just enough to be given something to work with. He's engaged enough to call the master king and lord, but he's really unwilling to follow him. He's similar to the person that's connected to the family of faith, but still not connected to Christ. He's missed the life and practice of discipleship. Luke 6, 46 and 47 have just wrecked my world over the last couple years. "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do what I say?" So Jesus asked there in Luke 6, 46, and he goes into verse 47 to say, "If you want to know if you're my disciple, you're one who hears my words and puts them into practice." See, a disciple is one who hears the words of Jesus and does something with them. They're one who hears the words and puts them into practice. And perhaps a third servant is one who heard the words of Jesus but is unwilling to do something with them. You see, to disconnect the doing from the hearing is to not understand the way the kingdom of God works. It's not really to understand the way life works. We're now parenting a 14-year-old and almost a 12-year-old. So listening and doing are important parts of functioning well in our household. It's like when you go see the doctor and they say, "Have you been taking your medicine?" And you say, "No, I have not." That's a game I play with our nurse. She gets very, very agitated with me. I sometimes take my medicine, but not always. She goes, "The doctor's not going to believe this. He's going to let you have it. He goes to church with me." And I always tell her, every single time I tell her I haven't taken the medicine, just so I can get a response. That's just who I am. But point being, there's something about doing, hearing and doing and how they're connected that's so important to life. It's so important to just going through things and going through the way of things. And so why did he not invest this mina? Because he was fearful. He was fearful of the master, although the first and second servants got it. They clearly were excited about the master, and the master was clearly rewarded them and evaluated them and was excited about their faithfulness to his word. And so here's what I want you to catch this morning, is that risk, along with discernment, is needed for believers today. It's our honor to invest all that God has given us for his glory and for his kingdom. It's our honor to turn it into kingdom good. I'm reminded of the story in Acts chapter 9. Saul is on his way to Damascus to persecute the Christians there. And when he's there, he runs headlong into God. He's blinded, and for 3 days he prays and he fasts. And while that's going on, Ananias is praying. And God says to Ananias, by the way, Ananias, I want you to go visit a guy named Saul. He's a terrible man, but I want you to go visit with him, and I want you to let him know that I'm going to redeem his life. And Ananias' response is, that's not really what I signed up for. But Ananias goes, Saul's eyes are opened, he's baptized, he becomes Paul, and then they go and they meet with the group of believers. The same people that Saul, now Paul, was intending to persecute. And then the same believers have to sneak him out of the city, and then they have to go and they have to explain to the believers in Jerusalem why he's a good man. Everybody in that story had to take a risk or risks. Is it possible that there are people in your neighborhood and in your workplace and in the hallway of your school and in your offices and in your community and on your ball team that are just simply waiting for you to take a risk in the name of Jesus to connect with them? Is it possible that God is doing a work in your life, and that right now, even as we are in this room praying and communing together, that God is doing a work in the life of someone else in this city or someone else in your family who can't even see that you are the answer to that prayer? But that God is asking you to take a risk on his behalf to use what he has given you for kingdom glory and for kingdom good. Is it possible that God has gifted you in a way to bless somebody else? Is it possible that God has entrusted you with a gift or talent that is needed for something or someone else that you cannot see or that you may not even know about? Is it possible that he's calling you to a place that you're unsure of? Is it possible that God has given you the gift of encouragement or sharing faith or hospitality? God has given you the gift of generosity that is needed to share with other people. See, here's my problem with this parable. I find this parable to be challenging and perplexing, one that gets me right in the gut, because every single one of us is going to be held accountable for what we have. Every one of us is going to be required to be accountable for what God has entrusted to us, and not just personally, but corporately. Someday, Jesus will say to this church, "What did you do with?" You can fill in the blank. What did you do with the location that I gave you? What did you do with the influence that I gave you? I have entrusted you with all these people and with all these talents, and what did you do with it? Because per this parable, the stakes are far too high for us simply to shelter ourselves and take what God has entrusted us and wrap it up in a piece of cloth and just hang on to it and wait for God's return. I'm troubled by what John Ortberg says. He says, when did Jesus say to his followers, God has a wonderful plan for your life, and that involves a great house, an attractive spouse, a wonderful job, a terrific car, an endless succession of easy days? When does Jesus ever say that? Jesus says this: follow me, follow a great big God, have outrageous joy, and you are going to be in trouble all the time. Risk is part of following Jesus. And I can say this because this is not my home church. This is going to be the death of the American church. It's because we are afraid and we are scared. And it is way easier to take our mina and to hold on to it and just buckle up and wait for the Lord's return than it is to do something gutsy and challenging and something that shakes the status quo. And our world is dying for the church to stand up and do something different. And are we going to be a part of that or not? Are we just going to be way better with just coming in and sitting in our comfortable seats and playing the game and going home and having a nice lunch and going, well, that was sweet and that was kind and that was good, and nodding our head? There's huge risk involved in following Jesus, but it is a ride that we will not regret. There's three different types of people in this parable. There's the good servant who looks at life and believes that everything is God's. And so they're the ones that share their stuff and their friendships, and they're open and they're generous. And they know what they've been given is just a gift from God. And so turning it out to other people is a joy for them. There's the wicked servant, those who are connected to the church but not really willing to submit to the lordship of Jesus. We're even willing to call Jesus master and king but not Lord. So we can be the kind of people that we play enough of a role where we're willing to be entrusted with something, but we completely misunderstand and misjudge the character of the master. You see, we're associated with the master, but we just don't trust it. Reminds me of the text in James 4. We know what we should do, but we don't do it, and therefore it's a sin. And so this is one of the spots in this text where it gets really confusing, and it's sort of difficult to tell who is who. Right? Because obviously in this story, the good servants and the wicked servant, they were all entrusted with the same thing. They just chose to do different things with it. So in a church, you can play this game in a lot of different ways if you're good. That's a little bit of sarcasm. You can roll into church and you can smile and you can play the good church game, but not really take what God's given you and use it for His glory and for His good. Jesus talks a lot about money, so this is kind of low-hanging fruit example. You can be a quiet person and be one of the most generous people in a church. You can also get up here and pray for the offering every single Sunday and never give to the church. But from the outset, no one would know any different, because it's about what drives us in our heart. Several months ago, we were having a conversation in our house about why do we give. And I can talk about it because it's a function of discipleship and because we're good stewards. But then we start getting down to heart motivators. If I'm really, really honest with you, the reason I have to give and the reason I need to give is because if I don't give, I'll start to think of myself as God in a hurry. I begin to look at it and say, look at what I can do. Look at just how good I am. Look how wise I am with my money. Look how much more I have to play with and to do stuff with. So I have to give, not just because it's a function of discipleship, not just because it's the role of stewards, but because it keeps me moving in the right direction. And so we've got to dig into our heart motivators this morning if we're really going to find out what it is that drives us. And so as I wrap up this morning, I'm going to raise four questions for us as we unpack this parable about kingdom living in our life. See, the wicked servant is scary because he or she is connected, they say the right things, but they're still not really willing to submit to the lordship of Jesus. So here's the deal. I'm going to ask you four questions this morning. I'm going to ask you to process these. And I know how this is how this goes. You can hear some of these questions and you can go, oh, that makes me really uneasy. And there will be another voice in your head that says, don't worry about it. You're fine just the way that you are. You're really okay. Can I say this to you this morning? There are shepherds and ministers and friends and people in your life group, people in your Bible class, whatever it is that you call it here, who love you dearly. And so this morning, as we process through these questions, as we wrap up, if there's one that just kind of pings you pretty good, would you find somebody and would you say, I just want to talk to you? Would you allow the Holy Spirit to do its work in your life, to touch you and to prompt you and to move you closer towards Jesus as one who hears and puts His words into practice? So here's the first question this morning. Do you habitually commit sin? 1 John 3:9, no one who is born of God will continue to sin because God's seed remains in them. They cannot go on sinning because they have been born of God. And then Romans 6:1, what shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? See, there's a difference in sinning and practicing sin. There's a difference between folly and stumbling and just planning for it and making time for it and looking at your calendar and thinking this would be a great time to pull this off because nobody will be around. If I can just kind of sneak over here and I can, I've got a perfect window, I've got a perfect opportunity right over here to pull it off. Here's the thing, every single one of us struggles. None of us are perfect. None of us are super Christian. But we can talk about being stuck in the cycles of habitual sin and the secret stuff that no one knows about. I promise you, almost every single person that calls me and says, I want to come visit with you, and we sit down and we begin to talk, and once we kind of get past the small talk, once we get down to the real reason that we're sitting there having a conversation, something along these lines always comes out. I never thought anyone would ever know. I can't believe she ever found out. I never thought he would start to look there and find it. Because, friends, everything that we do in secret, especially secret sin and the darkness, will always come to the light. It has to. I have a friend at home who's a therapist and spent a long time in as an addict. And one of the best lines that he has ever shared with me is he said, when he was in his season of addiction, he was mailing himself packages that would not be open for years to come. So recently I was visiting with a guy at home who has spent a long part of his life and addicted to drugs. He's now one of the leaders in our Celebrate Recovery ministry, and he's awesome. He's got so much energy. And he recently had a health scare, and I was asking him about it. I said, how are you dealing with it? And he said, It's packages that I mailed myself 20 years ago. I'm just now having to open up, and I'm just now having to deal with them. Because he was in a cycle of life where he was habitually committing sin. I tell young couples that I'm doing premarital counseling with, I said, you're making decisions right now. I'm not being funny, but being serious here. I don't think I've ever told Jake the story that Lincoln just shared with all of you. So I'm sure today we'll get to process that. So it's a package that I mailed myself some 17 years ago that I'm just now getting to open up. That's the way it works. Here's the second question. Do you seek to live a holy life by being obedient to God's word? 1 John 2:29. If we know that he is righteous, you know that everyone who does what is right has been born of him. And then 1 John 2:3. We know that we have come to know him if we keep his commands. So when you hear scripture taught, when it's preached, when you read it on your own, do you shrug it off? Do you say, yep, that's exactly what it says, but I don't want to do anything about it? Or are you a person who says, I'm willing to consider that. I'm willing to unpack that. Or someone who says, I get it, I got it, but I don't really need to do anything with this. It's not really about me, or I don't really care. I've got that one mastered. If we say those sort of things, it should be a red flag because the Holy Spirit should be testifying to the truth that is within us that God wants us to hear. Moving quickly, number three, do you love others? 1 John 4:7 and 8. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God because God is love. If the Holy Spirit is working in your life, if the Holy Spirit is working in our life, then we shouldn't be self-absorbed and narcissistic all the time. I was visiting with a guy that's just recently come to Jonesboro. He's going to teach at Arkansas State University. And he was telling me, he's one of the new deans there, and he was telling me that both of his children are in doctoral programs. And one of his children is working on a doctorate in presidential rhetoric. I know, that was my response. I laughed out loud. And I just thought, that's how funny. And he said, this is such a terrible time or such a wonderful time to be studying presidential rhetoric. And there's so much that can be said, but I'm not going to get into that. But anyway, here's the point. how we treat other people and words that we say about other people matters. We have this thing in Arkansas, it's called Facebook. You may not have it here. It's shocking that it got to Arkansas before it came to Alabama. But Facebook and what we do on social media can absolutely destroy relationships. I know this because I have seen it firsthand. I've had people sitting in my office who are so deeply wounded because of the way a brother or sister in Christ has treated them, or what they have said, or what they have said about their people, or what they have said about their family on Facebook. Do we love other people? Even if we disagree with people, are we willing to treat them with dignity and respect? Are we willing to engage them in reasonable conversations? Are we willing to treat them well? Here's the fourth question. Are your affections on the things of this world, or do you have any affections for God? Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, love for the Father is not in them. And finally, those who live according to the flesh have their minds set on what the flesh desires, but those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. Do you see the things of God, and are you reminded of His mystery, and do you want to worship Him? You know, like when you think about the cross, I spare you all the details of this, but here's the point. We're going through a big transition at home. It's a beautiful and wonderful transition. And one of the things that we've had to unpack, and we're unpacking this morning at home for people, is that the scandal of the cross is huge. And if you're a person, or if you know someone who's not a believer and they're moving towards belief, if you slow down and you think about it, the idea of saying, I believe in a Jew that was crucified on a cross and came back to life, and that I need to put all my hope and all my trust in a crucified man who was resurrected, that a book that was written 2,000 years ago talks about, that's a pretty big deal for someone to make that leap. It's huge. It's just gigantic. But we can get so knotted up in all these ancillary issues and all these ancillary things that we just forget about the power and the scandal of the cross. And when you and I, when we sit down and we think about the scandal of the cross, are we convicted that Jesus had to do that for us? And so even when the desert times come, do you still praise God? Do you have an appetite for the things of God no matter what? Some of the questions to help you process this. There's a third group of people in this parable, and we won't spend hardly any time there, but it's the subjects who did not want a king. And you go home and read this on your own, but their life does not end well. There's always going to be people along the way who are going to reject Jesus. And so this morning, as we wrap up, I want to ask you the question. Who are we in this parable? As Jesus tells this parable to encourage kingdom living, as it is connected with the encounter with Zacchaeus, as one who came to seek and save the lost, to eat with the tax collectors and sinners, who are we in this parable? Who are we in this parable personally? Are we the good servants who openly trust the ways of the master by living generous lives? Are we the wicked servants who look the part, who use the right language, but in the end aren't willing to trust the master? And the story says they get nothing. Or are we the subjects who don't want the king? Who are we in this parable as a church? Is this body of believers that meets here at Twickenham, or are we the people who openly trust in the ways of the master by living generous lives for the sake of this city and for the sake of others? Are we the people who look the part and play the right game and use the right language, but we're not really willing to trust the master when he asks us to take a risk? Or are we the people who just walk away from it all? I'm going to encourage you as a body of believers to take risks. For there is where life in Jesus is truly found. Let's pray together. Father, you are good, and you are righteous, and you are holy, and we long to know you more. Father, this morning I pray for my friends, no matter where they are on this journey of faith. Lord, I pray that you would work, and you would move, and you would convict, and you would prompt, and you would reveal yourself in mighty and powerful ways to all of us. Father, that you would help us in those moments where we say, I believe, yet Lord, help me with my unbelief. Lord, that in those moments where we'd say, I want to go where you're trying to send me, but I'm scared. Father, help us to be people who are willing to take risk in your name. Not just for our sake, but for your name's sake. And for the sake of our friends and our neighbors and our co-workers and our classmates and our enemies and those who we don't even like who are away from you. Lord, you're in the business of saving people, and we ask that you'd give us the capacity and the risk tolerance to join you there. Bless my friends that worship here. Would your name be great and be mighty among them. It is in Jesus that we pray. Amen.
If you say go, we will go. If you say wait, we will wait. If you say step out on the water, and they say it can't be done, we'll fix our eyes on you and we will come. Good and true. If you call us to the fire, you will not withdraw your hand. We'll gaze into the flames and look for you. If you say go, we will go. If you say say step out on the water, and they say it can't be done, we'll fix our eyes on you and we will come. We'll fix our eyes on you and we will come.
Thank you for being here today. Thank you, Chris and Polly, for giving up a weekend to be with us. Always a blessing to be with you guys, and we hope that everyone will take a risk this week. Let's stand as we close in prayer.
Thank you, Chris, for the lesson this morning. I was kind of faced with a decision. Go with the closing prayer or go with what was on my heart. And so bear with me, and I apologize if I get a little emotional. Last night, our son surprised us and said he wanted to invite Jesus into his heart. And so Jackie and I thought and prayed, and we sent some emails and some texts. And then this morning, Daniel gave a lesson on sacrifice. And I continued looking to make sure that I had prepared Tyler for this decision. And then Chris brought up accountability. What did I do with what was given? And I look back at when Tyler was born, and I remember going, okay, it's not just Jackie anymore. It's Tyler. I've got somebody else to feed. And it wasn't until last night, I think all parents, all the fathers think about this as we come to church and as we try to lead as an example, but last night I was faced, am I being the example I should? And every day I pray that I can be a better father. And this morning, Chris was pushing not just be a better father, be a better Christian. Do what God has asked us to do. And so today I pray selfishly for myself, but I also pray for the church that we all live the example that God has asked us to live. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning humbled by the wonderful gifts you've given us, the gifts that we do not deserve, the gifts that sometimes we feel inadequate to carry. I ask that you give us strength and wisdom to look to your word, to look to you, to focus on you, to find the strength to do what we know is right. To do what we know is right, not when people are looking, but when you're looking. To be honest and to be loving Christians to not only those in our family, but in our church, but those who want nothing but death for us. I ask that you give us the strength to support those in need, to support those in our church that are fighting illness, fighting doubt. I ask that you just give us wisdom this week to be the example, to be who you want us to be, to use the gifts that you've given us. And it's in your Son's name we pray this morning. Amen.